Good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome all of you to the Keller ISD Board of Trustees. We are re-meeting in regular session. Today is Thursday, October 12th, and it is 6:31 p.m. All board members are present now.
Good evening. We'll begin tonight with the outstanding students of Bette Perot Elementary leading us in the pledges of allegiance. Immediately following the pledges, Principal Lisa Young will come forward and introduce her students. At that time, Board Vice President Karina Davis, will you please come and shake hands with these students?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Good job, guys.
Good evening. I'm honored to present our Bette Perot Elementary Ambassadors Group, and they represent us well in so many ways. So this evening, first on my right is William Hine. Marley Hies. Morgan Hies, Kaylee Johnson, Logan Kelso, Clara Marsh, Maggie Meshi, Taylor Wolf. Thank you for inviting us to begin the meeting this evening.
Thank you, Mrs. Young. The next item on our agenda are more awards and achievements.
In your board packet, you will find student and staff achievements on pages 6 and 7. We will be taking photos of all honorees in the lobby immediately following our last award. For our first award tonight, I would like to invite Board Secretary Ruthie Keys to please join us as Director of Guidance and Counseling Jennifer Fleming presents our ROCKstar of the Month Award.
Okay. One of our values in Keller ISD is that we demonstrate good character and ethical behavior. And we observe this every day from our students that reach out with character and kindness. The Keller ISD Character of the Month for September is good citizenship, and our rock star student is Allie Weick, a 12th grader at Keller High School. Allie was nominated by Shannon Jenkins, who is our coordinator for elementary counseling, but she remembers her from Liberty, I believe, as her counselor. So over the last few weeks, we have all had some, we've had some homecoming games. We're all familiar with this. With the games comes the inevitable Texas-sized mom. And Allie implemented a campaign for the 2017 homecoming at Keller High School. She, rather than purchasing supplies for the traditional homecoming mums and garters, Allie and the student service organization were offering an alternative. She developed a plan to have students purchase t-shirts that support the community storehouse. Many of you are familiar with the storehouse and its mission to close the gap between opportunity and excellence. It is her hope that this initiative will help pour money back into the community and benefit others in need. Her demonstration of good citizenship to the greater good makes her an excellent rock star for the month of September. So Allie, in appreciation of for your character and kindness, the Rock Committee has a small gift for you. Thank you, Allie.
Thank
For our next award, I would like to invite board members Jim Stitt and Beverly Dixon to please come forward. Our September Hard at Work recipient is a college and career readiness teacher at Hillwood Middle School. She was nominated by HMS Principal Kathleen Eckert, who said, "Marla rocked our fundraiser for the Desert Storm Memorial, and when it comes to teaching, she works hard to ensure all students are learning. More importantly, though, she works hard to build relationships with students. She knows her content very well and will do anything for students and our campus. She embodies these outstanding qualities and is truly awesome." Ladies and gentlemen, please help me congratulate our Hard at Work recipient, Hillwood Middle School teacher, Marla Bratch. Our next award, I would like to invite board members Brad Schofield and Chris Roof to please join me, and Chief Financial Officer Mark Youngs, if you'll please come forward. Keller ISD is committed to the highest standards of school system financial reporting, which is reflected in two major finance awards, both the Government Finance Officers Association and the Association of School Business Officials honored Keller ISD with certificates of achievement for excellence in financial reporting for its comprehensive annual financial report for the fiscal year ending August 31, 2016. These awards are the highest form of recognition in governmental accounting and financial reporting. Keller ISD has received both of these awards for 10 consecutive years. But there's more. Keller ISD continues to remain compliant with the Texas Comptroller of Public Accounts for exemplary efforts in creating financial transparency on the district website. Keller ISD earned the Transparency Star Award in 2016, a program that recognizes local governments for providing clear, consistent information about public spending in user-friendly formats. Congratulations to the Keller ISD Finance Department. Let's begin tonight with Finance Director Kristen Williams. And in alphabetical order, Anita Crable. Martha Cantu. Jessica Dobson. Aaron Fiscus. Amanda Horn. Margie Rideout. And D.R.C. Robinson. Unable to attend tonight, Debbie Adams, Shalisa Hollis, Misty Ketchum, Kelly Lee, Leanne Richards, Lisa Rogers, and Susie Wing. Congratulations again to the entire department.
I feel like chanting 10 more years, 10 more years.
At this time, I would like to invite Board President Cindy Lawton and Superintendent Dr. Rick Westfall to please come forward for our Innovative Teachers Inspiring Students, or ITS Award. Our recipient will receive $500 from the M.K. Evelyn Hudson Foundation to spend on his students. The Keller ISD October ITS Award is Independence Elementary's PE teacher. He was nominated by IES Principal Mark Basham, who said, "His passion for getting students' brains and bodies active is visible in his innovative instruction professional network and the impact he has on our families. He's taken physical education to the next level. He has more than 900 loyal Twitter followers, and his tweets often start a chat that leads to hundreds of other PE professionals collaborating and sharing ideas. He is an integral part of our community. And when he's not sending personalized videos to students' parents celebrating their child's achievements, he's collecting their activity schedules so he can go watch their games or performances. He's brought our school and community together through physical education, and his impact extends beyond the walls of the gymnasium, our school, and this district. He's a distinguished teacher in Keller ISD, and we are lucky to have him. Let's take a look at our It's Award recipient in this brief video.
I'm Jason Leach, PE teacher here at Independence Elementary. Hey, team.
Hey, hey, coach.
Hey, hey, team.
Hey, hey, coach.
Today, we're working on overhand throwing. My challenge this year is to combine solo taxonomy and plickers so I can use that information together to understand where the student believes they are at. B, if you think, well, I've got it, I want them to know what we're working on, why we're working on it, and how they know they achieved it. From the information provided by the plicker magnets, I can follow up with that student and help give them more feedback so they can boost their confidence where they're at on their skill. The PE take-home tubs, it just came from a student walking into my equipment room and saying, I wish this was at my house. The idea hit me that what a wonderful idea would students be able to come up with their own games and activities, play with their family, and encourage the family to get up and get out and get active. Recently, I put this on Twitter, and right now, there's between 8 to 10 schools that are starting their own take-home PE tubs. And I'm very encouraged by that to see other PE teachers that want to encourage families to play together. I love teaching PE because I love to teach kids about leading a healthy lifestyle. You can see what they've accomplished and how your teaching has impacted their lives.
Who wants to play turtle tag more often?
Me!
Ladies and gentlemen, please help me congratulate our It's Award recipient, Independence Elementary School teacher, Jason Leach.
I'm just glad we didn't have to get up and do the little dance again like we had to last time. Although it was really good, I have to say. All right, the next item in our agenda is audience with individuals, and we didn't have anyone sign up this evening, so we're going to move on to the superintendent's update.
Thank you, President Lawton and trustees. I just wanted to highlight a couple things. The first thing I want to talk about is the Hudson Foundation. Later on in the agenda, you're going to see an action item that we're going to ask you to take action on in terms of a donation. But it merited at least making sure that you knew the extent to which the Hudson Foundation has helped Keller ISD over the last few years. So I'm just going to read off a few bullet points here. They started in 2010 in Keller ISD supporting the work in our classrooms and our schools. It started actually with a $40,000 grant. Over the last 7 years, the Hudson Foundation has granted Keller ISD over $1 million to assist in some of the innovative programming that's going on in the district. This year, the grant is totaling $350,000 that they're going to be bringing forward, and that, again, we'll ask for approval on. But I just wanted to highlight a few things that we're working on this year. The KISD Art Show, the Keller Shake, KISD It's Award. We just finished up some of the Keller Shake stuff. You just saw a video on the It's Award, Ron Clark Academy Training, Art Studio Days, Creative Experiences, Hudson Innovative Grants for other classrooms. It's just a great way for this group who has really bought into what we're doing in Keller and has supported us. And when you combine that with the Education Foundation and the support the Education Foundation gives us as well, it is two wonderful ways to help bridge the gap that we're dealing with right now in school finance. So I just appreciate their work and all that they do. The other thing I want to give you an update on is our visioning process. As you know, we have kicked that off this past week. We've talked about it quite a bit, and it was we finally got to do something with it in the month of October. Our first two education summits were at Fossil Ridge and at Timber Creek. We had about 80 people total show up there, and the next two are actually Monday and Tuesday of next week, Central High School and Keller High School, from 6 to 8 p.m. The biggest piece about this that I want to make sure that especially the trustees are aware of is that those meetings that we've had so far are not walking away with, and this is what we're going to do. They're walking away with really causing people to think a little bit differently about how we're going to do education going forward. So they've been great conversations and really forcing people to think differently, and we actually joked around a little bit about it. If they're leaving frustrated from the meetings, then we've accomplished our goal. If they're really forced to think about what we're doing. We actually also have questionnaires out there. If you've seen the website yet, there's a couple different things that people can be involved in if they can't get to the education summits. One way is to fill out a questionnaire that we have. It doesn't take real long. We've had over 200 questionnaires already filled out. And that's the online version. Cecil updated me today that we have a hard copy version as well from the summit. So we're probably hitting around 300 questionnaires already done. That's just within the first week and a half or so. And we have another link that if people want to stay connected to what we're doing in this work, I know that came out of our Team of Eight training, just the suggestion of make sure people are given the option to volunteer. And we've had 153 people volunteer already to date. So I think the more the word gets out about this, people will be interested, and we're allowing them to express their voice and to show interest. So anyway, I just want to make sure you had that update, and I'll continue updating you throughout this process. That's
all I have. Thank you. All right, the next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Okay, a second? Right. All those in favor of the consent agenda? 7-0. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is action item A, approval of employment recommendations.
Board of Trustees, on pages 28 and 29 of your board book, you will find the action item and corresponding list for employment recommendations. These individuals listed, as well as those we reviewed in executive session, are being recommended for contractual employment with Keller ISD for the 2017-2018 school year. Administration recommends the Board of Trustees approve the employment recommendations as presented.
Thank you. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
All right. I'll give it to Ruthie, and Chris can be second.
I'll be second.
All right. That's fine. All right. Anybody have any questions for Tommy?
Yeah.
All right. All those in favor? All right. Thank you. 7-0. All right. The next item on the agenda is the approval of the Hudson Foundation grant funds.
Good evening. The M.R. and Evelyn Hudson Foundation is a local granting organization focused on children's issues, discovery experiences, arts and culture, and K-12 education. The foundation has been a longtime partner with KSD, and as Dr. Westfall mentioned earlier, there are many projects and programs and experiences afforded to Keller ISD that would not be possible without their generous support from the foundation. The grant for the 2017-18 school year is our largest grant to date, totaling $350,000, and includes district projects such as the KISD Creative Learning School Initiative at Trinity Meadows and Eagle Ridge Elementary, the KISD District Art Show, the Keller Shake, ITS Awards, Hudson Foundation Innovation Grants, Ron Clark Academy Training Workshops, and Creative Space Transformation Projects. We would like to thank the Hudson Foundation for their continued support of KISD. The administration recommends that the Board of Trustees accept the Hudson Foundation grant as presented.
Thank you, Kim. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Jim got it, sorry. Okay. All right, any questions for Kim? All right, well, I'm gonna tell you that last week I got to go over for my campus visit, and it just happened to be the day when Kim was over talking with Susan Mackey about all the cool stuff that they're going to get to do at Trinity Meadows. And I got so excited. I was like, it almost made me want to go back to work. Not really, but
almost.
It was just the life I saw and the teachers. And I just have to tell you that this woman is completely underselling herself, because she has worked so hard to make this happen, and she was such an, I mean, everything they said, they were like, Kim was like, oh, I know somebody that can help with that. I mean, she had like this, she was like a magician pulling things out of her purse and her iPad and showing us pictures. And I mean, so I am fully confident that the reason that the Hudson Foundation is so generous with us is because of the hard work that you do to translate the things that the teachers are doing to them to communicate, because they see it, and that's what makes them encouraged to give us more. So I just want you to know that that was awesome. But it was so fun, and I just thought, this makes teaching fun. It makes being at school fun for the kids and for the teachers. So it was really cool. So my speech is over now. All right. Anybody else have any questions? All right, all those in favor of accepting this money, thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, we are going to pull the next item because Amanda is sick today, and it's not something that was time sensitive. So we're going to pull item C from the agenda, and we're going to move on to action item 9D, the approval of district and campus performance objectives.
Good evening, everybody. It is that time of year where we come to you and ask you for your approval of our performance objectives for our annual district improvement plan. So I'm here tonight to share those performance objectives with you and kind of give you a little context and background with that. As you are well aware, we use the KISD strategic plan to anchor all of our work. Every function and department annually develops their own improvement plans, including performance objectives and strategies that support the achievement of those objectives. In analyzing these plans this year, 14 performance objectives were identified as high priority in supporting our key strategic priorities for the year, the five core. What follows will be a summary of these 14 performance objectives. You also have a complete copy of those verbatim in your board book there for you. I would like to note that our DEIC has been extremely helpful in providing feedback on these this year. At their recent October 5th meeting, they shared their thoughts and also their questions with us as we shared these goals with them. Their feedback will be shared with the function leaders as we go through the year, because most of the feedback had to do with how we were implementing, you know, what were the strategies. They also kindly reminded us that we often use educationese in some of our documents that we put out. And so I really appreciated the honest and sincere feedback. And so we made a few tweaks in wording to a few of them based on that. And I did want to publicly thank them for their involvement in the committee and also for their commitment to the purpose of DEIC. So we want them to know that we're listening to them. To start off, our first priority would be to increase student achievement. Last year, the educational support function came together and aligned all of their support, training, and development strategies to one purpose, the goal of every student achieving 1 year's growth. And that would be measured by district and state data. They are continuing on this path for the 17-18 school year with a specific focus on 1 year's growth in reading and in math, and also an additional focus in increasing student performance in writing. As you know, when we look at how our students perform historically, the passing rates have been quite high. In our analysis last year, we concluded that targeting every student for 1 year's growth would be inclusive of all of our student populations, from our highest achieving students to our most struggling learners. As Jennifer Price shared with you this summer, we were pleased with the overall increases in student growth, but this year they wanted to more clearly define and take an additional step and target reading, math, and writing specifically. With these objectives focusing on every student's growth, they are committed, we are committed, to meeting each student where they are and supporting their growth as a learner. Moving into our community, parent, and student relationships, as Dr. Westfall has just updated you, one of our big areas of focus this year will be the strategic visioning process. and bringing that to you in May for your consideration. Updates coming probably every board meeting along the way. Another thing that we're focused on this year is redesigning our feedback strategy. As noted, we've had 80 people attend our visioning process summit so far. We've had 200 people or 300 people respond to the questionnaire, but we're really looking for even more engagement and in different ways. So we're reconsidering how we approach gathering feedback and how we communicate with our community on what we're gonna do with that and how we use it internally. We're also focusing on developing public awareness in Keller ISD about finances and operations. And that is coming out of, as you know, in the last legislative cycle, there was a lot of dialogue about public education funding, not a lot of legislation coming out of that conversation. But what did become apparent to us was that there is a desire within our community to know more about how we're funded and how the funding impacts our operations and our day-to-day work with kids. And so as a result, our media services team is teaming up with our finance department to help share factual information with our community to increase their awareness of how it all works. Moving on to our fourth priority. I'm sorry, I've skipped one, haven't I? Go backwards. I just skipped over processes and systems. I might need to check my process on that.
That's what's up.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We are working in our technology department to update our intranet for our community. You all know K-Connect. You're familiar with it for the past years. So we will be working this year to streamline access to information and resources and develop a more modern platform for that for our internal community. We're also, Joe and his team are working on increasing the safeguarding of our business and learning practices with a new, more updated framework for basically protecting our information. Every so often, we're up to date, and then times change, and we need to stay current with that. So you can expect this to be an ongoing project. Incrementally, every 3 or 4 years, we need to come back and revisit this. Hudson and his team are working on improving our facility services through a new effort, also in tandem with Joe's team, on a work order management system. And this is intended to streamline and make that whole process run more smoothly for our campuses in particular. And Amanda and everybody else will be working on a two-year, that's not a typo on the goal, it is a two-year goal, of revisiting our administrative regulations, doing a thorough review and update of that whole entire system, and then also digitizing that so that it's actually accessible for everybody a little bit more easily than it has been in its current form. Now, employee excellence and organizational improvement. Our benefits and workforce team is working on a healthcare campaign for our employees that will help them understand and equip them with the knowledge and skills that they need to navigate their healthcare and manage that for themselves. We want them to be aware of the options that they have out there as far as healthcare service providers, facilities, you do have options for that. I know that was news for me as we were going through some of the recent conversations, is that there are a lot more options than I was aware of. We want them to feel confident with the tools that are provided by UHC, so Sherry and Tommy and their team will be working diligently this year to build some informational campaigns and providing support to our staff in that. And then lastly, we are all, under Mark and his team's leadership, undergoing a shift in our fiscal year end, and that is to more closely align, as you are aware, with our school year, our contract year, our grant year, and this is really going to impact our internal processes and planning cycles for our campuses and for our teams. So big internal shifting obviously financial stewardship is something we get a lot of recognition for, so just trying to be even more efficient and effective in that area. So as you'll notice, many of these performance objectives in this year's plan are increasingly cross-functional in nature. So I point to Joe, I point to Mark, they're working together. Shelley is working with Mark. All of this is done in an effort to be more aligned towards shared goals. Obviously, everything in key strategic priorities 2 through 5 are really intended to help us achieve our students' growth and learning in key strategic priority 1. All of that to help us continue to work towards achieving our mission. So at this time, on behalf of all of our function leaders, our departments, teams, and campus leaders, I would respectfully ask for your approval of not only the district improvement performance objectives, but also the campus improvement performance objectives that you were able to hear from our campus principals last Thursday at the campus carousel. We are all more than happy to answer any questions that you have.
Okay, thank you, Leah. Do I have a motion?
No, we got to have a motion first. Sorry. I know. It seemed like a report, but it wasn't.
Okay, do I have a motion? I'll move. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right, thank you, Beth. Okay.
Chris can't work the mic.
Punch the button.
Struggling over here.
Like a Jeopardy. You got to be quick. Any questions for Leah about the performance objectives?
I have one.
Okay.
I think that we do an incredible job with the faculty and staff as far as that healthcare piece. But I'm really concerned about the health of our teachers. Not just through the healthcare, but what's put on their backs in the classroom to achieve these goals. And so, you know, the time that they're spending, and, you know, I've had so many people recently, you know, say, I don't know if I can do this anymore. You know, just the time that they're, you know, because so many things are added to their plate, but nothing's taken away. And so for us to achieve that high excellence in student, you know, achievement, you know, I'm really concerned about our teachers. And I think that we need to think about what we can do to help them out with that. Because I think that there are so many of them that are really struggling right now to try to get everything done so that we as a district can meet these, you know, goals of achievement. And you know, we have the health care, and yes, they can go and work out and they can do this and that, but what about them? You know, I just wanted to put that out for, I think we need to think more about them.
Thank you, Ruthie.
My comment.
I would speak as a teacher and as a staff member that in my work with our educators, I feel like they are our number one resource. They are our everything in front of the kids, that they wouldn't happen without them. And I think we all know that. I know that we've been engaging in several conversations recently with our teachers. I know even in FACT last night, there was quite a group attending FACT this evening to discuss some of the concerns that they had raised. And so we have ways that we're hearing them, and we continue to ask and seek for their feedback, and definitely want to acknowledge the work that they're doing. And as we continue our conversations about our plans and the strategies that we're putting in place, we definitely don't want to do that in isolation without making them part of the conversation.
Yeah. Thank you, Ruthie. Anyone else?
Leah, are all of the functions participating in each and every one of these goals?
Every single one. I wouldn't say every function participates in every single goal. For instance, the heavier involvement for some of them is going to rest in one or two functions. We might all be impacted by them. We might seek feedback from each other as an end user of something that's been created in one of those goals. But I wouldn't say that we all collectively own every single
goal. I'm just thinking that the more the functions understand what the primary function is trying to accomplish, they can either assist or at the very least get out of the way. So assure me that, you know, those discussions were held, that everybody is aware of the priorities and that
Absolutely.
They know what they can do to help and they know how they could hinder if they didn't assist the other functions.
We do discuss these objectives. We've talked about them for the past few months in our leadership team meetings. They are ongoing conversations within our internal leadership. We update one another. I know, just for an example, in DEIC last week, Sherry and Tommy's team came and focused heavily their time with DEIC on their goals and shared information and resources. So there's multiple avenues where we're keeping each other in the loop and also listening for stressors or conflict or misalignment. And that's the beauty of the way that the plans are set up within our system. We come to you every so often. We reassess. If something's not going well, we can adjust mid-course and recalibrate and make a correction and move forward.
And you will report on these quarterly to us?
I will be back in December, April, and then a summative report in July.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
I have a question. I thought I heard you talk about school finance and putting something together with the production team.
Our media services team has been working with our finance department, and they are basically pushing out a social media campaign, and you'll also see topics of interest in some of our other more regularly held meetings. But if you're interested, Shelley can definitely describe a little bit more detail.
Okay. Sure, why not? Yeah.
Thank you for the question. We're excited about it. We actually launched 101 last year, The More You Know, the video, and so we're continuing that campaign. And it's not just about finance. That goal mentions finance and operations. So we want to humanize it, and the best way for us to do that is to have these videos where people can quickly get a 360-degree view of what it takes to run Keller ISD. It's everything from athletics and finance, governance, workforce, you name it. But we're excited because we're looking at some different areas this year to feature. That's just one aspect.
Okay.
Social media is also another.
That's great.
So our templates are, you know, They're devised to come out on a regular basis and provide facts and figures and information. They come out Monday. So let's see, I have a list here. We have Monday Maintenance Mondays. We have Teacher Tuesdays, Westfall Wednesdays, whoever that is, Throwback Thursdays, and Finance Fridays. And that's a template that comes out on Twitter. And, you know, we're able through Twitter has analytics, so we're able to follow who is actually able to see it, which posts are crossing their Twitter feed.
Awesome.
So it's just one of the many ways that we can help tell our story.
That's good. And a little plug for community ambassadors. It'll be happening on Monday, a piece of what you're talking about, right? The education of our district. The first one kicked off a few weeks ago. It was fantastic. Mark did a fabulous job talking about finances of the district. I would tell you, as a new board member, I've learned so much in 3 months, and there's so much that you will pick up. If you have the chance to come out, please do. Thank you.
Monday
Chris,
night.
I challenge you. I've already done one of their videos. I did it on the bus routes. Now it's your turn to go.
Challenge accepted.
Hey.
All right, any more questions for Leah?
No.
All right, all those in favor of the district plan? Thank you, 7-0.
Thank you all.
Right, we had nothing pulled from the consent agenda, so the next item in our agenda are reports, and we're going to have an update on demographics and enrollment. Mr. Templeton.
Good evening, members of the board. Dr. Westfall, tonight we bring you a board report from Templeton Demographics. This report is our quarterly report review by on demographics, and we'll cover economic conditions, housing market, and enrollment forecast. Presenting tonight will be Mr. Bob Templeton from Templeton Demographics.
Thank you. It is my pleasure to be here with you tonight. Just on a personal note, my daughter is student teaching at Hidden Lakes Elementary
year.
I can't believe it. It seems like yesterday she was in kindergarten, and here she is student teaching at Hidden Lakes and having an incredible experience. Tonight I will touch on the economic conditions that are taking place across the area. Specifically, we're going to look at the housing market in the Keller School District, and we'll touch on the enrollment projections. We nailed the enrollment projections this year, literally less than 20 students off district-wide, so we had a very good year this year concerning the enrollment projections. I will say, if I could get the screen up, let's see. The DFW economy is one of the strongest city economies in the country. So the Dallas-Fort Worth market has not slowed down at all related to job growth. In fact, our job growth rate is 2.5%. That's roughly about 88,000 jobs being created annually. You'll see that the national rate is 1.4%. So we're literally either the second or third fastest job growth city in the country. And we don't see any signs in the near future with that changing due to the amount of massive jobs that are coming to the area. And so luckily we're seeing very strong job growth across DFW. When we look at the unemployment rates, the US unemployment rate is at 4.1, Texas at 4.4. You know, some months it gets to about 4.5. 4.5 is about where the state and the national rate has been. But you'll notice the DFW area at 3.8. The city of Keller's at 3.9. So this area specifically, I would classify as fully employed, and we'd categorize that as basically you have everybody working that really wants to be working. The housing market is across DFW at about 31,250 annual starts. To put that in perspective, in the boom housing period of 2005, we were building 50,000 homes. So the DFW area is building about 31,000 homes. We're growing about 100,000 people a year in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. So the housing market is still going to be in a very, what I'd classify as a very hot period. The additional challenge that we're going to face in the housing market is the hurricane, and what's happened along the coast is going to cause some inflationary factors related to materials. So the construction, sheetrock, plywood, PVC pipe, a lot of those materials, we're going to see those escalate up just because of the increased demand down in the Gulf Coast area. You know, some numbers are showing that Houston lost anywhere from 30,000 to 40,000 homes lost. And so there's going to be a huge surge there to get that rehabilitated, replaced. And so that is going to cause a little bit of pressure on an already hot housing market. It's very good news if you're a seller. So we're selling homes at a very fast rate, and the sellers are getting the asking price. And so for the sellers, it's good. For buyers, it's a little bit of a challenge. And for especially the younger buyers, it's really having them look at existing homes, which that's very good for Keller. The ranking report, this is a ranking report based on annual closings, and you know, it wasn't that long ago that we were in the top three in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. We're down at number 12. We started about 800 homes in the last 12 months, ending in the second quarter. We closed about 787. You'll notice we've got about 717 vacant developed lots. Those are lots that are available for builders to build on today. We've got about 1,868 futures. Futures are preliminary plats, additional phases. There's some of those infill neighborhoods. I'll say we've probably got about another 1,000 lots in raw land in some little spots, but you'll notice we are toward the end of our building surge, single family. With that amount of single family lots, you know, at about, I'll say at about 3,500 when you include some of the raw land. So we've got between the single family and the multifamily, I'm going to say about 3,000 to 4,000 students of growth in the single family and the multifamily market. So we truly are at that period of seeing the end of the growth surge within the next 7 to 10 years. I don't know if that's good news or bad news, but it is the reality that we are looking at. This is looking at the starts and closings by quarter. You'll notice we closed about 417 homes through the summer months of 2017. We've started about 336. Here's a map of the elementary attendance zones and where the most active neighborhoods are. You've got Sunset Valley, which is closing more than 100 homes a year, and you've also got Liberty that's closing more than 100 homes a year. Now, there's a huge difference between the yields that come between those two elementary zones, and it all has to do with price point. So it's the price point of the homes in Liberty, much more expensive, so we have a lower yield. Many of those families are, this is second, third homes, empty nesters, fewer kids. There are some kids, but not as many as what we'll see in Sunset Valley. Sunset Valley is a production type builders, lower price range, and we'll have a little higher yield in those areas. Those yellow zones are building between 1 and 50 homes a year. The orange zones are building between 51 and 100 homes a year. So this is just a quick way to look at the map and kind of see where we do still have growth from the single family housing market. This is the map that shows where the vacant developed lots are. Liberty has a high concentration of vacant developed lots, as does Freedom, due to Remington Falls. So Remington Falls has got about 76 vacant developed lots. But in the top 10, we've got about 436 vacant developed lots remaining. You'll notice West Fork Ranch, they've got about 61 vacant developed lots. So some of these neighborhoods are definitely going to be building out, and we're going to see them slowing down within the next 1 to 2 years. Here's where the futures are. There is a concept plan that we've seen for that future alliance area in the Basswood Elementary Zone. That's roughly about 250 single family lots. In Freedom, we've got the Keller Hicks addition, which that's kind of been in play and in discussion for a couple of years. So we still have it on the books, but there's not an imminent project that's about to kick off there. So, but it still potentially represents about 200 lots along in that Keller Hicks addition. Here's a ranking report that shows all of the single family housing by the elementary attendance zones. Of course, you'll notice Sunset Valley with over 341 annual starts, but they've only got about 70 vacant developed lots and about 182 future lots. So you can see within about a year and a half to 2 years, Sunset Valley's single family position is going to slow down quite a bit. This is a map from 30,000 foot to kind of show you those green are the active subdivisions that are building some houses. Although it's spread throughout the district, I would point out that those neighborhoods that are building in Florence, it's also like Liberty, very low yields, very expensive homes, so we're not seeing a large surge of kids from those houses because the price range is so expensive. Some of the quick details on some of the neighborhoods that we're watching. Watson Creek Estates, about 122 future lots. The groundwork starting in January. The lots should be delivered in the first quarter of 19, so it'll take them about a year to develop and deliver those lots. The developer anticipates building about 50 homes a year. That price range is 290, starting 290 to 375. It's hard for me to believe that 290 is an entry-level home now. That's at the lower price range. Builders can't hardly build them cheaper than that. Part of it's due to the cost of land. Part of it is the cost of materials. And so it is just the inflationary impact that we've seen in the housing market over the last 5 to 7 years. Just to the south of Watson Creek, we've got Remington Falls. It's 81 total lots. All the lots have been delivered. The first homes are under construction. That price range, $250 to $325, that's in the Freedom Elementary Zone. Fresh Meadow Estates, so this is, again, some of that infill development that we're going to see in those spots around the district that we'll end up having. You know, this one's got 46 total lots. The groundwork is underway. Lots should be delivering this October. That's in Liberty, so it's going to be a higher price point as well. Parkview, 55 future lots. The groundwork is also underway there. Lots delivering by the end of 2017. The developer anticipates building about 15 to 20 homes per year. That price range, $300,000 to $400,000. That's a surprise to me. It'll be interesting to see. Yes. Whitley, what did I say? The name of it is Parkview.
Yeah. The name of it's Parkview. Whitley Road Elementary.
It's in Whitley Road Elementary, yes.
My goodness.
Huntington Estates, 79 total lots. It's only got 6 vacant developed lots left. There are 5 homes under construction. It'll be built out by the end of this year. That price range, $263,000 to $300,000. That's in Ridgeview Elementary. West Fork Ranch, you know, it has been our most active subdivision over the last couple of years. It's about 1,223 total lots, 182 futures, only 61 vacant developed lots remaining, 77 homes under construction. There is groundwork underway on about 173 lots that's nearing completion. The developer anticipates building about 270 homes through the build out there. It should be built up by the end of next year. So by the end of 2018, and built out. That price range is $200,000 to $340,000. You know, there's going to be some opportunities for likely commercial through there, but we have seen situations in some of our other clients that land that we thought was going to be commercial could end up being single family. I'm referring to the Capel School District right there north of the airport on 114. That 10 years ago, I would have never thought there would have been single family houses that close to the airport amongst the industrial warehouse area that it is. There's now over 1,000 homes on both sides of that freeway. And so I mentioned that just to say, when you can see this, we do have a significant spots of land here that as the market will decide. Right now, that those areas are not zoned single family. They're zoned for commercial mixed use. There is some multifamily in there. But I can tell you just from my experience over the years, it's much easier to go to a single family. That zoning doesn't meet as much resistance as there would be if they tried to make it multifamily. If they tried to make it multifamily, it will meet resistance. That's why most of this land that's zoned multifamily along 35, that zoning was put in place 20 plus years ago. It was put in place by, some of it was Hillwood, because there wasn't that many people around, and so they didn't have the notifications, and there really wasn't opposition that really could surface that far ago. But I mentioned that just that we do have some opportunities for some infill of some single family that could happen here. Now here's another one of those spots, future single family. It's approximately 140 acres, potential for about 550 single family lots. There is approximately 50 acres of mid-density single-family units that could result in about a total of 900 units. The developer is 1 to 2 years away from beginning any planning. So we've not seen a official plat. This has just been our research team in discussions with this developer and them sharing some information about this sizable piece of property. It is in the Basswood Elementary Attendant Zone. Junction Crossing, 277 units of multifamily. First units anticipate to open in the summer of 2018. It is split between Northwest and Keller, but a majority of the units are in the Keller School District. So approximately 209 units would fall within Keller, and about 68 units would fall within Northwest ISD. This is going to be a real challenge in terms of determining who really belongs in which district. But it's in the Sunset Valley Elementary Zone. Right now, our understanding is that these are market rate apartment units. So the market rate has a little bit less yield than what we would see in a subsidized apartment complex. So out of that 277 units, it could be 30 to 40 students total, but a majority of those students would likely be elementary because we do see higher elementary yields in apartments just due to the age of the kids. It's a little bit harder to have your middle school and high schoolers in multifamily, so we likely will see mostly elementary in that neighborhood. Now here's just looking along Old Denton and just east of I-35 to give you a picture of the multifamily. Those kind of blue outlines, which would be 7, 8, and 12, those are existing multifamily units. There's about 1,400 units in the existing. The two purple, they're under construction, and those are about 532 units in the purple shaded areas. And then that turquoise, those are future multifamily projects. There's zoning in place for these. We've seen some concept plans for some of this, but this represents about 1,865 multifamily units in the turquoise section. We've got some notes there on what we understand to take place, and so I'm not going to go down each one of those. But you can see that that I-35 corridor is definitely, it's filling in. We've got already seen the retail, and now we're seeing some of the multifamily, and it's likely just going to continue to kind of fill in over the next 3 to 5 years. The challenge is going to be, just about all of this is market rate multifamily. So it's going to have a yield of anywhere from 0.1 to 0.2 at the height of the yield. But the challenge will be 10, 20 years from now, as these apartments age, it is fairly common for us to see a change in the strategy of the complexes, and they can become more affordable, and we can see some change in yields down the road. So that's gonna be our challenge when we look beyond 10 years, are gonna be these swells of students related to the multifamily. But in the short run, we're really not gonna see a huge surge of numbers from these in these apartment complexes just due to the rent is so expensive that it does preclude a lot of families because the rent rates are so high. The millennials love these mixed-use apartments that are located close to restaurants and entertainment. I've got my son who lives in Houston and his wife, they love their little area that they're in. And so it is a phenomenon that we're seeing now with the millennials that this is very appealing to the millennial group. Now, what we believe to be the case is that as the millennials get into their family forming years, when they get ready to start having children, that we'll see them leave the apartments and get into single family at that point. And so it is believed that the millennials will have the same or similar birth rate numbers, but it's likely going to be in the early 30s when they enter those birth rate years instead of the late 20s, which is what we saw the Gen Xers. I apologize for getting off on that. Here's a look at the enrollment projections. This fall's enrollment was 34,970, and you grew about 310 students. The yellow is the largest grade per year, and you can see the ninth grade continues to be our largest grade. The green is the second largest grade, and right now our largest two grades are in high school. I will add a cautionary comment that we are getting to a point to where right now I would caution us to look at the projections just for the next 5 years. Don't pay as much attention to the back 5 years, the last 5 years, as I would the next 5 years. I've been doing this for 20 years. I've been involved with school districts for almost 30 years, and I've never seen an environment so difficult to work and forecast in than what we're seeing right now because of the millennials and the changes in birth rate patterns, but also because of the charters and the competition that we're seeing from surrounding school districts. And right now, this forecast is based on what we know about the charter picture right now. But charters can pop up very quickly. They can pop up with very little notice from the city or from the TEA. We know that International Leadership Academy is going to open another dozen campuses in the next couple of years, but we don't know where those are going to be. Last year, they settled in Eagle Mountain Saginaw, and they opened up a campus right in the middle of the Eagle Mountain Saginaw School District. And we didn't get notice of that opening until about October of last year. So this time last year is when we found out about the Leadership Academy in Eagle Mountain Saginaw, and it opened up a year later, and it opened up with 1,200 students, just like it did in the Keller School District. So I mentioned that to say, you know, when we look at these projections, really focus in on the next 5 years. Now, I mentioned earlier, I think we've got enough single family and multifamily housing to grow another 3,000 to 4,000 students, which that would put you at about that 37,000 mark in 10 years. But the things that can cause some wrinkles to this is IDEA charter, international leadership. Those charters that'll pop up will start to, could potentially siphon off more students. But what I have also noticed is we are seeing a return. So the charters are having a very similar effect that we also see with homeschool and private school. Parents will use the charter in the homeschool, private school through elementary, but then when they get up into the secondary grades, they can't compete, and so then they come back. So we're already starting to see a little bit higher cohort returns in those secondary grades like 6th, 7th, and 8th. So we'll start to see those patterns in 6th, 7th, and 8th where they come back into the public schools to take advantage of your strong secondary programs. This is what the projections look like at the campus level, and I won't go over each campus, but what I will point out is that you've got some elementary campuses that are going to be getting, you know, getting pretty large. You've got Cap Rock that's going to float up near 700 students and get just a little bit over 700. You've got, you know, Freedom that's at 560 that's going to get to about 645. Liberty, because of that price range, even though they're building significant housing, it's going to stay likely below 500. We don't really see it getting over 500 students. Lone Star, you know, that's been one that's been pretty big. It's right at about 814 students right now. They're starting to see some larger classes in their fourth grade than what they've got in kindergarten. That's the thing that I look for at Lone Star is we need to see those smaller kindergarten classes coming in that's going to naturally provide some lower numbers at Lone Star. So we've been on the edge there with those numbers, but it could start to trail off as we see smaller kindergarten classes coming in. At the secondary level, well, let me back up a little bit and show you the grade level. What I want to point out at the grade level page, fourth grade, that fourth grade number is 22,764. So that's a little bit larger than the fifth grade and sixth grade. So there's going to be a little bit of growth in those intermediate campuses just because of this fourth grade class that's coming. That same class is going to eventually hit the middle school grades. And so you're going to see some little swells at the intermediate totals and the middle school totals, and it's because of this fourth grade class that's coming through. So the middle school numbers, we've got about 5,023 students in the middle school grades. The other thing that's kind of skewing these numbers a little bit is what's going on with Vista Ridge. So Vista Ridge right now has fifth and sixth. Next year it's going to have fifth, sixth, seventh. And then the next year it's going to have fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth. So when you see that middle school numbers growing so much next year, it's because that Vista Ridge is adding a grade level. But you'll notice at Parkwood Hill, that's our largest intermediate right now, and it should start to trail off in a couple of years and get just a little bit smaller and stay at about that 1,200 number. At the middle school campuses, we've got Hillwood that's getting up to about 1,300, and then we've got Keller Middle that's getting just a little bit over 1,000, and Trinity Springs getting over 1,000. So those are your largest middle schools. At the high school level, of course, Timber Creek is your largest. It should start to trail off just a little bit. And we do anticipate it could stay at about 3,200 students over the next 10 years as those younger families that are up in that northwest portion of the district start to work their way through. So all in all, you know, we see that we've got about 34,970 students right now, and in 5 years we could have about 35,900 to 36,000 students in the next 5 years. I'm going to summarize, then we'll go back and have some discussion and answer questions. Of course, the unemployment rate in the Keller area is below 4%, so we have a very strong economy related to how we sit with the rest of the DFW area. Keller ISD had the most second quarter closings in more than 6 years, so we closed a large number, but we are going to start to see that number slow down simply because we're starting to run out of lots. The district roughly has about 1,800 planned future lots remaining. The Alliance Town Square has about 532 multifamily units currently under construction and roughly about 1,865 additional units planned. Keller ISD can expect an increase of about 1,350 students during the next 5 years. That'll put our enrollment in 2022 at 36,323, and in 10 years we could have about 37,400. Be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Bob, for that thorough report. Any questions down here for Bob?
I don't have a question, I have a comment. We just sold our house and bought a new house, and in looking at those houses, you know, we went out and we were going to see how far on that Keller edge we could get, and there was a house that was across the street that was in Northwest and one in Eagle Mountain Saginaw that was $50,000 less than the exact same floor plan in Keller ISD. That's not good. So we moved 5/10 of a mile from our own house. So there you go. We stayed in the neighborhood.
Anybody else?
No, but I think the numbers that we saw for Watauga builds also reflects that, right? It's incredible to hear that kind of pricing for that area, but that speaks to how much the district does impact the local economy and the housing markets.
Yes. So,
it's good for us, but it's very eye-opening to see those kind of numbers come back.
I have a comment.
Okay.
Well, really more for the, I guess, the administration or board. Some of the older schools that we're seeing on here, if we're seeing an older school, I guess like Keller Middle, increasing with a lot of students, knowing it's an older school, we probably need to start planning ahead on getting it up, you know, getting new chillers in there that aren't 40 years old, and, you know, because we're seeing a big influx of students. You know, just, you know, I'm just one I saw, but I mean, you probably have a list of them, but, you know, we just need to look at that. Whitley Road has a big construction. I don't remember how it's going to go on its students, but, you know, the big construction, you know, houses across the street from it. And, you know, just look at those older campuses, and if we have a demographic, you know, seeing a big influx of students, we probably need to put a little more work into them.
I agree. I think Hudson's on that. We have a 10-year plan, right? If not, we will. Just kidding. Okay. Well, thank you, Bob. That's
thank you. It's always a pleasure for me to be here, and if you think of any questions, don't hesitate to send them to the administration. Our office is right down the road here, and we love what we do, and it is interesting to see where we're at. When I've been doing this in Keller for about 20 years.
Yes, a long time.
And it still blows me away that we're at 37,000 students. When I started with Keller, we were 14,000 students. Mm-hmm.
And Bob has always been, he's always been spot on. I mean, we've not had any surprises or anything like that. So you've done a great job for us.
I have one more question. Bob, in your opinion, do the facilities that we have on our west side, will they hold the growth that we're expecting in the next 3 years, or where are we going to see the overcrowding, if possible?
I think one strategy that we'll just need to be very proactive, and one of the things that I'm a little concerned about is that future Alliance single family. That was a pretty big number. So we may need to look at I hate to use this word, spot zoning, to put that area to whichever elementary school has in reason. You're not going to send it real far away, but we may want to look at some spot zoning to put those in ahead of time, before families get there, to where
yes,
you
please.
where you have space, so that you're not having to be reactive and move those after the fact, because that's when it becomes so much more painful. So I would say we need to be have a strategy that we're watching it so closely and looking at our campus enrollments, that when we see a plat for the first 150 homes, and then we look at which campuses in the area have the space, and we spot zone it. That way you don't have to do the attendance zone adjustments to help with that. That would be one strategy I'd recommend to help with that infill growth that's going to happen, so that you're best utilizing your buildings without having to either rezone or add capacity to a building.
We don't like that one.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, anybody else? All right, thank you, Bob. Mm-hmm. All right, the next item in our agenda is a special education update. You don't look like... Okay, it's like, you don't look like Trish.
You've changed.
Wow, there it is. Yes, Dr. Custer's out sick, and there weren't any coordinators available, so you get the C team. I will
spend all afternoon doing this.
Absolutely. On page 70 of your board packet, you'll find the special education update for this evening. The intent of this report is to provide the board with an accurate, up-to-date picture of special education in Keller ISD. As you'll see on the following slides, the number of students requiring extra care and additional support continue to rise each year. I'd like to begin this evening by sharing the goal of the special education department. It is our goal to serve as many students as possible in their neighborhood schools in the least restrictive environment by providing as much of a full continuum in each school as possible, considering staff, resources, and space. This chart shows the current number of students in the life medically fragile, and transition classes, as well as the enrollment numbers over the past two school years. Life is a self-contained program that serves students with deficits in cognitive and adaptive skills, needing varying degrees of lifelong home and/or community support. The current recommended ratio in our live classes is up to 10 students per room with a teacher and two paraprofessionals. Life Medically Fragile is a self-contained program that serves our students with severe medical challenges. These students require nursing services and a great deal of personal care from our staff. The target ratio for these classes is up to 5 students with a teacher and two paraprofessionals. Transition classes are designed for our students who have completed 4 years of traditional high school. We serve identified students through age 22. Transition 1 serves students working on employable skills. The approximate ratio is 10 students with one teacher and two paraprofessionals. The adult transition 2 has a suggested ratio of 2-6, and adult transition 3 a ratio of 2-5 due to the severity of the disability of the students. STAC is our Structured Teaching Alternative Communication class. STAC classes are designed to provide alternative curriculum and instruction to students who demonstrate significant social, communication, sensory, and behavioral difficulties. Students in STAC typically require extensive support in addressing their communication needs through speech, language services, and/or alternative communication systems. STAC suggested ratio is up to 6 students with one teacher and two paraprofessionals. STARS is our Structured Teaching Alternative Resource Setting. STARS classes are designed to provide general education curriculum and instruction to students who demonstrate social communication, sensory, and behavioral difficulties. STARS target ratio is up to 20 students with one teacher and one paraprofessional. STRIDES classrooms are designed to provide instruction and behavioral support to students with the intent to reintegrate them back into full-time participation in general education classrooms. The current district suggested ratio is one teacher, one paraprofessional for every 6 students. This year we have added Core Academy, designed to provide general education curriculum
to our students with significant emotional and behavioral needs. These students have not been successful in the lesser restrictive settings, such as strides due to behavior. In addition to the general education curriculum, these students are receiving social-emotional learning curriculum to increase their pro-social and coping skills. Students enrolled in Core Academy are reflected in the strides numbers on the slide.
What's it called? I'm sorry.
Core Academy.
C-O-R-E?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
This chart shows the current number of special education students enrolled at our early learning centers and enrollment over the past 2 years. Please keep in mind that this is not total ELC enrollment. This chart reflects only those students identified as special education at those two locations. The PPCD program is for children with disabilities at our early learning centers, age 3 and 4, with an individual education plan. Teacher-student ratios vary in PPCD based on the amount of support required. Pre-K blended is for students with disabilities age 3 and 4 who participate in general education pre-kindergarten classrooms with special education support. TALK is designed for students with speech disabilities ages 3 and 4. In TALK, students receive support in articulation and language development. This chart shows the increase in Keller ISD special education population from October 2012 through October 2017. As you can see, there is a significant increase in the number of special education students being served by Keller ISD each year. In the current school year, we have enrolled 4,720 new students. 259 of those students were special education students. So approximately 5.48% of our new enrollees for 2018 were identified as special education. This chart shows a current breakdown of the main identified disabilities served in Keller ISD. Please keep in mind that while these are the categories with the largest number of students being served, we also have many students in lower incident categories being served, such as visually impaired, deaf, blind, traumatic brain injury, etc. As a special education team, we are working hard to better define our programming and create a full continuum of services for our students. I'm excited to report that we have a registered behavior technician cohort of 10 participants working to expand their expertise in the applied behavioral analysis process to better support our students. Likewise, I'm excited about our focused emphasis on 10 elementary campuses for best practices. We've already seen positive results in reading performance for students on the identified campus. This concludes the special education update. I am happy to answer any questions or relay those questions to Dr. Costa.
Thank you, Kevin.
You have questions down here for Kevin that he can pass along?
From reading your script and what was up here on the screen, there seemed to be a little difference. Can you go back to the stack stars screen?
Yes, sir.
I don't know if this is significant or not, but the last word, behavior needs under stack and behavior needs under stars, you had behavior difficulties in your script.
Yes.
I think there's a difference between difficulties and need.
I would agree with that, sir. The slide should also read behavior difficulties.
Okay.
And you said that the kids in the core program are included in the strides numbers?
Yes, ma'am, that's correct.
Can you tell me where that, I mean, is that an elementary program?
We have an elementary program and we have a middle school program.
Okay.
Those numbers are relatively smaller numbers, but we have one that serves our elementary students and one that serves our middle school students.
So they go to a different campus? School.
Yes, ma'am.
If they become eligible for that program?
Correct.
Okay.
I don't have any questions, but I'm always amazed at the growth that we see year over year, because while we just listened to our demographers who are talking about how we've slowed in our general growth, certainly in this area we see very much the inverse. So I appreciate all the hard work that's put into this to keep it functioning and provide those services to those students, because I know we get a significant number each year, and it's much harder than taking in that same number of gen ed students. So definitely appreciated.
Thank you. I'll certainly pass that along to the team.
I don't know if you can answer this, but those core students, once they leave the middle school setting, is there a plan for them, since it's a new program this year, what they're going to do at the high school level?
This is the first year that we've had Core Academy. I know that Dr. Koster and the team are working on what happens next. This is something that she's had some experience with from previous district, and something that she's also been in contact with other districts about to develop that plan.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else? Well, you know, if they build it, if you build it, they will come, and that's what's happened. I mean, we have amazing programs and reputations, and I know from personal experience that people have left districts to move to Keller for their special education programs. So while it's difficult, I feel very honored that people would trust their most fragile children with us. They trust their kids with us for sure, but to trust a child that has emotional or developmental issues with us, it's huge. And so I think it's a badge of honor that people want to come here for special ed. So even though it's a huge burden, I'm glad. So thank you, Kevin.
Because financially, it costs a lot more to educate those kids.
Yes, they do require some additional resources.
Lots of it.
Right, thank you. Right,
thank you.
I know that you're going to be sad, but we are going to have to miss the top 10 new laws for trustees because Amanda's not here. So don't break any laws until she gets back. And we'll move on to our discussion topics. Do we even have that? Because
yes, we do.
Oh, okay. I saw the word policy, and I was like, no, we're not going to.
This policy that we love.
Now I'm back with us.
Okay.
Jennifer, before you get started, are we going to get a list of the top 10 laws that affect us? I want to take it home and kind of memorize it.
We'll have to wait. Hopefully I'll close it out with this wonderful information that we have here. So this is familiar. You guys have seen this before, but I wanted to update you on what's been going on since we've had our meetings and talking to parents and families, students and stuff, to keep you updated on what we've been working on. Our why hasn't changed. The policy related to rank and GPA does affect every single secondary student, even though it's going to be implemented with our middle school students, starting with them. Again, when we began looking at ways to decrease pressure for our students, this was just one piece. We know that there's other things that we need to work on, but this is one piece that we can start with, and it can affect our students in a positive manner, letting them have more of a voice in what they're choosing. So, this is what's been going on for a few months. I wanted to give you a timeline of how this kind of all started. We know that we've been talking about this for a few years, but we did discuss this with administrators, teachers, students, parents to gather their input and feedback. Every time we've had a meeting with our stakeholders, we have returned to discuss possible considerations and made some revisions, because they have brought up some specific things that we should definitely look at. Most recently, it has been our feedback from our 8th grade parents. So if you remember, in August, we had meetings at every middle school, and we found that when we started talking to our middle school parents, specifically our 8th grade parents, they were wanting more. Why, when we were talking about rollout, this is just for 7th grade, this is just for 8th grade, they came back, well, why can't we have that too? And we hadn't thought about that. We didn't know that we were going to get that type of response, and so we went back and started looking at ways that we could maybe implement a few more things, but we did tell the parents that we wouldn't be making changes that would be detrimental to our current 8th graders. So what we did find is that our current 8th graders
are enrolled in over 1,800 high school courses right now, which if we made some of those changes, it could be detrimental to them. So we want to make sure that we're not putting that in, but there are some things that we could do. And so we went back to the drawing board to see how could we help institute some things that they've been asking for. So I'm going to go over each piece. We're going to talk about what the current policy is. I'm going to show it to you, what the revision or the recommendation is, and then I'm going to bring up specific concerns, feedback that we received on each one, so you can kind of get an overall picture of what's been going on the last few months. So the first one we have is the ranking of the top 10%. Currently, we rank all students every semester, and we know that their GPA is calculated each semester. We are recommending to only rank the top 10% on the transcript at the end of the junior year on the transcript while calculating the GPA every semester, and we would report the cutoff score every semester for the top 10% students. With this particular piece, this is some of the main feedback that we've received. So how will I know where my student is? The cutoff score will be posted for all. What we're working on is that the parents will be able to get access to this information on their home access center to be able to see it. But it wouldn't necessarily be posted on the transcript until the end of the junior year when it's sent to the university, because that's the first time they would accept a transcript for a student for admission. We're also trying to change the focus of the student interest on their health rather than focusing on it's posted, where am I? Let's kind of look back at what do I want to take, what am I interested in? So, but making that available for the parent on the parent side. We also have the concern of our 6%, now that UT came out with their 6%, 25% is probably the next one that we would look at. Anything beyond that isn't very helpful to students, but how could we help those students that are in those scenarios? And so the counselor is always able to provide the information for the students that would benefit from being in the top 6%, or if it changes in two more years, 7%, however UT goes back and forth, and then those within that first quarter, or other ways, depending upon if it's maybe scholarship specific or private school specific, it's just communicating with the counselor with what we need when they provide that information. A student and their parents would always have the ability to know the stuff that they need to, in order to apply to the schools. And then the question came up with some parents of how would it help to rank a student beyond the top 10%, 11, 12, 25, 50, it really doesn't. Because posting the rank on that transcript initially sends that university the message that this kid is 25%, 50%, 75%, and that's what they look at right off the bat. If we remove that and say that we don't rank past then they open up that holistic view that we had talked about before, and they don't just say, oh, he already has this piece, 50%, we're not gonna look at him. They have the opportunity to use their rubric and see if this is a student that they would like to have come to the university. So eliminating that piece for the student would be helpful rather than posting it on there and putting them in a bad situation at the beginning. So what questions, I was gonna stop here because we're gonna talk about each one and see if, can I do that? Mm-hmm. And see if we had any discussion pieces on the first piece. Okay. Next one, the final senior ranking. Currently, the final senior ranking is completed for commencement purposes at the end of the 5th-6th weeks grading period, and a percentage of the 4th and 5th-6th weeks is calculated with a cumulative GPA. What we're recommending is to take the final senior ranking for commencement at the end of the fall semester of the senior year. A couple of concerns that have came up, some feedback that have come up with our parents. Seniors will quit working so hard on their classes if their rank is complete. We don't typically see this overall, because when a university accepts you for admission and says we accept you, it's contingent upon you finishing your agreement mm-hmm. that you're going to complete this. So we haven't seen that as something that students typically do. We should take the ranking at the end of the second semester of the senior year. That timeline doesn't match up, and that was a question from a few parents, but it doesn't match up with commencement. It doesn't match up with admissions, so it wouldn't help our students. And then the third one was students have fallen out of the top 10 or 10% from this percentage that we take from 12 weeks of work. And that is correct. It does occur. This could result in one assignment, one test that's taken over that short period of time that moves a student out of the 10% or out of the top 10 after 3.5 years of working towards this. So putting it at the end of the fall semester would eliminate that piece that we have currently going on. Any discussion, questions about final senior ranking? We currently have 300 plus courses that we use to calculate GPA and rank. Here's just a list of them, and courses taken in the middle school are not included. If we look at what we're recommending, these courses listed above are those that are required to earn a diploma in the state of Texas, and all students have to take it. So we understand this is a considerable decrease from our 300 plus, but these courses are recognized for basic admissions, and you can see students who are concerned about their weighting will still have the opportunity to build those slim pathways that they build currently now, and they are isolating them around a lot of these courses because they know the colleges want them. The thing that we're looking at here is that we have included dual credit in this, and we have also dual credit courses have been included, and then courses taken in middle school would be included in here because it is just such a small number of required courses. Here we
academic
have
courses taken in middle school that are high school
academic
credit.
Courses. So for example, like the Algebra 1.
Okay.
Yeah, Algebra 1.
Okay. The ones from the other list that they take in middle school
are not currently.
Okay, but mm-hmm. they will be.
But they will be
okay.
going to the 17.
Right.
That's correct.
Because yes. currently, if a middle school student is taking a high school course, they're not getting, it's not being considered, it's not being included in the GPA, and
that
it will be moving forward.
Yeah, they get the credit, it's just not included in the GPA right now.
Mm-hmm. On that sheet you had, it's kind of hard to understand.
Which one what do you want me to go to?
The one we talked about. The R, what does the R mean?
Thank you for asking that. R means regular. Then we have the pre-AP, D means dual, and the AP is advanced placement. We don't have every level in every course. It depends on what's available through College Board with advanced placement or maybe agreements that we have with TCC or other entities for dual credit. So those have been built accordingly.
Okay, here's a dumb question. Are they going to be weighted?
So we're getting to that.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
No, we're good.
It wasn't a dumb question.
It's not.
Okay, I was
not.
Like,
what was
right
the,
here.
What was the R again?
The R is
regular.
Academic.
Regular
academic course.
Regular.
On level.
Algebra.
That's another
what
way
about
to put it.
AP, like biology AP?
It's on there.
It's on there.
Mm-mm.
We have a biology pre-AP on here. That's so when you take science courses, you take biology regular or pre-AP first, and then you're allowed to take biology AP, but biology AP is not required for college admissions. Biology is, but not the AP course.
Okay, so biology AP doesn't count towards your GPA?
Not in the new one.
Because they're just gonna count the courses that are required for college admission. All those other things will be on your transcript and look really good,
mm-hmm.
but they won't be part of your ranking because we're just gonna use this bare skeleton of classes for the ranking and the rest of it. That's pretty much what's behind the whole thing is that frees kids up to take a lot of those courses, whether they get extra points for them or not. And so all these are required, they have to take these. But the others they're just gonna have a lot more freedom to take
and
the things.
Brad,
that
if I can clarify something for you real quick, anything that's still labeled AP is still going to bring weight.
Weight.
It'll still have a weighting to its grade. It's just it won't be one of the courses that's calculated for the rank. So it's still going to be out there weighted. There'll still be a GPA with it. But when it comes to ranking, it'll be a different calculation, only including these courses.
And that actually matches us up to what the colleges and universities do. Because what we do right now, when our kids send the information in, they break that apart and strip mm-hmm. it all back down, and this is really what most of them are looking at anyway, and they recalculate. So this actually lines us up for those students to have that more strategic linear effect like we do through our schools. It also lines us up to the next level then, much more clearly for the students.
So what we're saying is the biology AP does not count for your 10% to get in within that 10%. It doesn't count for that.
It's not required.
Okay. And because no college ever counts biology AP.
Well, so the student still has the opportunity to earn college credit by taking an AP course, whether it's included in our stuff or not. That's separate with College Board. What I've been describing to parents is that there's two parts of admissions with college. The initial admission process, which is really this piece. This is what's required to get in. So once you get in and you get your ID, then the other piece is, okay, did you take biology AP? We know it's not calculated in, but you wanted to be a biology major. Now let's start looking at that. That's on your transcript. Do you have the scores? Do you want to, this will help that student on that end. So it takes it further. It's like this two-step piece to get into not just the university, but now the major that I want or the college that I want. So what we have, when we were talking about this, we have engineering courses that kids won't take because they're not weighted in any way. There's no AP, there's nothing. They can get into UT, but they can't get into the engineering program. They didn't do any engineering courses because they were focused on taking all of these other AP courses, trying to gain a weight and gain a rank. So they're skipping those kids and saying, I'll give you a general studies major and you can go to UT, but you won't have an engineering major and go to UT. So this would allow them to make better choices to work towards those specific programs and not be penalized by points on our end. We were penalizing them.
What would a child think if a biology AP class doesn't count towards his GPA and he's at 9.5% in the top 10, what would make him want to take that extra hard AP class knowing it could knock him right out of that 10%?
He would take it because he has the opportunity to earn college credit.
It won't matter if you don't get in the college that you want.
But it might for his major, if that's what he wants. We're really talking about what the students want to take in their interest. So if a student wouldn't just take biology AP because I have nothing to do with biology, they would take the other course of interest for them. But if it was to benefit them after they're already admitted, well, yes, a student would, because maybe I could get some college hours out of this, and maybe it'll help me get into my major once I get into the university.
Okay. I want to make sure I clarify something, though, Brad, because I heard you say something. I want to be sure I'm understanding, because you said what would cause a student to take AP Biology if there's a potential that's going to knock them out.
And I'm talking about a kid that's really smart that's taking an AP class in 10th grade.
Right.
I'm not talking about like 12th grade. I'm talking about some smart kids that are taking them in 10th. Why would they do that and risk not getting in the school that they want?
Because it's not going to knock them out because it's not part of
it. It's not part of the calculation.
We're pulling it out.
Knock them out because it...
Right, but if they're spending extra time on that AP class, there's always a scale. If you push the scale down, something else is cause and effect. So they work really hard on their AP biology to make a good grade. That's going to take time away from some other class that may count on this. That's what I'm saying. So they're putting extra time in that AP class that they could just get a blow-off class, but they don't want to, and they're really putting that extra work, which causes them, their chemistry AP to drop because they're putting so much into biology AP. Now we've got an issue because now that kid's not going to the school he wants to. Hey, but he gets college credit, just not getting to go to the school you want to. What's more important to that child? Going to that school, forget about the credit.
So you're talking about workload. If they're opting into a course,
I'm talking about people working the system and trying to work it to their best advantage. Mm-hmm. And y'all aren't thinking about every single angle that these kids are going to be thinking and their parents are thinking about because they're trying to get in that college.
Well, but they're not going to take a biology and a chemistry class at the same time. And so...
That was an example.
Yeah.
But I could sit there and throw another class in here.
But
I mean, we could talk about geometry. I mean...
Brad, the thing about this system here is instead of taking all AP classes because they're trying to get their average up, they'll only have some of them that'll be... There's six classes on here that they could take that are AP, and those will count towards their GPA versus taking all AP classes and not taking any of these other classes or in their interest classes or,
you know, band or choir or the fine arts that gives them a balance. And as a student goes, when they're applying to a college, they want a well-rounded student, which is part of the reason UT's gone to 6%, because they don't want all these kids that have only taken all these AP classes and haven't taken anything else to broaden their horizons. By doing this, and this is, I'm coming from a seventh grade parent who have a child who's very advanced and is always wanting to be that 100% student, we had told her all along, I don't want you to take AP economics to get your GPA up, because you want to be a writer. I want you to take a creative writing class. I want you to follow that path. And this allows those students to focus on these six AP classes. And then if science is their forte, then they're going to take that biology AP, biology 2 AP or biology class to go ahead and test for it or get them into that college once they've, you know, that specific college within the university. But those kids that are going to take the AP classes are going to take the AP classes, but this allows them to not take every single class AP to get their GPA up. This allows them to focus on these classes specifically for their GPA and then take those other classes that they're very interested in. And typically when you're interested in a subject, you tend to perform better at it. So if biology is really the way they're going to go, then when they pick up that extra AP, they're going to do well in it. It's not going to affect their other classes because it's their interest. But the way we have it now, these kids literally just take AP class after AP class after AP class when they have no interest and they're struggling, they're doing 10 hours of homework a night, and they're not doing any of these other things that high school students should be doing. They're not involved in the clubs, they're dropping out of choir, they're dropping out of band because they can't balance it, or they're staying up all night to do homework and coming to school and not functioning properly as a teenager should do. So this is just kind of a balance for them. But if they're gonna take biology AP, an AP biology class, they're gonna take it regardless because they're looking to either test and get that credit, or that's just their interest.
Or any other.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I also know I've got a child that is well balanced, and he's in band, and he's in all this, and he's doing AP, and he's doing pre-AP, and I also see the struggles that he has and the stress that he has. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's not, you're saying he's going to pick up band. If they're not already in band, they're not going to be picking it up in 11th grade. They're going to be dropping it because they
need
to be focused on this
stuff. That's what they're doing right now. They're dropping it.
They are dropping it.
Band, athletics, choir, all of those, because that's bringing down their GPA. So we know that they're going to work the system. They're going to figure it out, whether it's this system or this system, what system is better for them overall. And so that's kind of what we're looking at. You know, for their social health, for their choices that they feel that they don't have right now because they feel forced into this slim pathway that they've created where they're taking 4, 5, 6 in some cases AP courses just to get points, but they don't want to be in all six. They only want to take the ones that they're required to do, but they're competing. They're really trying to compete. I really wanted to do this, but I had to do this. Those are the stories that we heard over and over at our meetings with parents of current high school students who now have a middle school student who's coming.
Well, we've had those high school students here mm-hmm. speak to us directly who have said, you know, you've put me between a rock and a hard place, and I'm doing exactly that. So it is the voice of the students.
What thinking about those who've been involved in those discussions you said at each of the middle schools, what are we doing to further educate parents so that they can better direct their children down the right path to start with?
We have started that over the last few years. We've been doing iGraduate meetings, which are very well attended. And 7th and 8th grade parents come to those. We will start those at the end of October, and they find out all of this information. We started a little bit in intermediate, but we really hone in on 7th and 8th grade because they're starting to pick those courses that are going to count that they have in high school. So educating them that way, and then through their iGraduate modules. So in each middle school, during advisory, they receive curriculum in the fall and a little bit in the spring where we're walking the kids through. Let's build a plan. Okay, what would that look like? And educating them on, look at all these opportunities you have. And we've been doing that for a couple of years, every year revamping a little bit.
Okay, just incorporating all the new stuff.
Absolutely.
Here in your
Well, we haven't incorporated anything yet.
Right, no.
We're educating them on the current.
Right.
On the current
stuff. 8th grade meetings right now are not very effective. We went through one last year. It was not very worthwhile, I didn't think. You know, you talk about all the things they can take, but, you know, that's nice, but the other part is got to get into college, you know, and if you want to get into a specific college, you got to be the 10%. How are you going to get there? and everybody's worried about, oh, what fun class can you take? That's what it seems like.
I think that, you know, Jennifer can take that back with her to talk to the counselors.
Absolutely.
About being more specific. But to me, this whole thing rings with our visionary strategy, that we're trying to change the way that we think about things, and we're trying to change the way that we do education in Keller. And it's going to be painful. I mean, mm-hmm. It's going to cause anxiety and stress for the counselors, for the kids, for the parents, for the teachers, because it's a big change. It's a philosophical change, and change is hard. So I think that we need to work together, and we need to not be fighting each other about it, and just talking about the things that give us angst, mm-hmm. and talking about the things that we feel are good. But you know, it just goes along with, we have to think about the future and the things that schools are looking for, and college changes every year, and the requirements for college change every year. And I feel very certain that within the next 5 years, they're not going to have an automatic admission to anywhere.
Yes.
That's going to go away, because it's not working.
It
it's not working for UT. That's why they're just ooching it up. It's
that's
not working for A&M. It's not working for any of the Texas schools. I feel pretty confident that it's not going to be part of the conversation. So we need to start thinking about what is going to be part of the conversation. So, you know, we're not going to fight on this. We need to get together as a community and as a school district and decide what we want this to look like, and it needs to look different.
It is in line with what states are doing outside of Texas and California. Texas and California still have these same rules, but the other states have made changes. They're not ranking. They're eliminating a lot of these pieces because the colleges have said, I want that holistic view. I keep talking about that. They want a different type of student. They don't want to be mandated to take a certain type of student. And with the current bill that's on the table, it will change. I don't know when, but I do expect that we'll see some changes with that, because A&M is not happy. These other people are coming up, our high entrance or attendance universities, and saying, I want to be able to do what UT's doing. I want to be able to do this.
Well, even years ago, when I was a high school counselor, the Ivy League schools were already stripping.
Mm-hmm.
They could care less that we weighted our classes. They didn't care.
They'll strip them in.
And,
they strip
and
it out?
So it's already been happening. It's just no one's been aware of it, unless you're a high school counselor or you have a child that's applying to Yale.
Yeah.
But if you're not falling that narrow category, then you didn't know that this was going on, but it has been going on. And so we need to do it different. So
Jennifer, I know you got some more slides to get through.
I do. Here was just a sample student I wanted to show you. So everything highlighted in the yellow would be the things that would count for this student in their GPA and rank. And then you have the green there. Those are 16 courses of choice that they're not penalized for. It's not calculating anything. It's what they are going to do well at. And so some of the feedback that we got from calculated courses, excuse me here. Elective courses are bringing GPAs down. We talked about that. We said that they're dropping out of those electives, and they are. They're currently. We did track that. Dual credit should or should not be weighted. I know this has kind of been a little heated, but with dual credit, most districts, if you look outside of us, do weight their dual credit courses. They do. We are one of the few that actually don't do it. We do have embedded teachers, which is different from most districts. So we can take the curriculum that comes from TCC and work with our teachers to make sure it's up to the rigor, the challenging college course that it should be. And the feedback that we have received, what we did receive from those eighth grade parents is, well, my kid doesn't choose dual credit for two more years. Why can't it be counted? I want some weight there because my kid's a dual credit kid. They're not an AP kid. And we know that there's a difference. There is. Students choose not to take certain AP courses because it's students will choose not to take my course if it's not included in GPA. This comes up because of courses that you had mentioned, biology AP, art history AP. Those things aren't in basic requirements. Right now we have students choosing certain courses just for the points, but have no interest in the course. So would that change a little bit? That might happen. They might decide, I'm not gonna take AP Bio because that's not my love, but I really wanna take this other course. So you would essentially have a class of kids who really wanna be there, signing up for those courses. And then some students don't excel in the graduation requirements. We know this, that's across the board, but we can't change that. The state has set those graduation requirements, and that is the one consistent thing that we have for all students in the state of Texas. The weighting system. This is our last one. Current weighting system, 10 points or no points. So pre-AP and AP receive 10 points. Dual courses, no points. Regular and elective courses receive no extra points. And we also have the piece of junior and senior level of academic decathlon do receive 10 points there. What we're looking at is the graduated weighting system. And so we're wanting to decrease the gap of points that students receive. A student may choose three different levels, so you can see that dual credit and pre-AP is in here. A student, pre-AP has been separated from AP. It's not as rigorous as AP. It is less rigorous, so we moved it down. Whereas dual credit is a challenging college course and is more challenging than a regular course. So in talking with parents and seeing the new graduated scale, they were happy to see that we kind of came to a happy medium of, okay, I can see why that fits where it does. And so we had this feedback from them, which I just said, my student's not an AP student, but they really could do well in dual credit. We see that. Our numbers are growing. At Keller High School, we have over 300 kids taking dual credit. They want it. Let's give them some opportunities. But right now, they're just taking it, and they're not getting points. But that's because they are getting college credit. They're taking it because they want the college credit, and they're paying for it. So I think my kids would make better choices with a different weighting system. Absolutely. You can see here, by having a 98, what the scale is. And so, am I gonna take regular? Am I gonna take pre-AP? There's, if I look at a 98, it's a 3.8 or a 4.3. There's different decisions that can be made rather than what we have is the 10 or zero. And so, they might be more strategic in choosing. And those are the kids that, you know, we generally see those. If we have, we talked about the rigor of the dual credit courses being a challenging college course. And if we have a tie, we do have this system that's been strided to a single data point. We automatically go up 4 decimal places for our grade point average, and we will have steps to prevent a tie. Students would have to earn in our system here over 17 courses each semester, 4 years, and have the same weighting for it all to match up, which is very rare, but we do have some things that we would put in place. So what we have are the things after getting the feedback from the parents and rehashing and, you know, considering some of the things that they said, a rollout like this. Here we have our ninth graders entering high school in 18-19, which is our current eighth grade. They would get these first three pieces, the top 10%, the final ranking, and then the graduated system. The only change that would occur for our current seventh graders is the reduction to the 17 courses. The last thing that I really want to say about this is we really need your help to change this focus for our students and our parents. I got to tell you, when Dustin and I went out, we were pleasantly surprised with the overall support that we received from the middle school. And these were large meetings. There was plenty of people attending. At our first meeting that we had at Hillwood, we had parents with tears. They were hugging. They were, I can't believe we're doing this. Why didn't we have this for my high school kid? But my middle school kid will benefit from it. We have had high school students in our meetings stand up and say, gosh, I wish I would have had this opportunity. Families made comments that they were just excited that this was coming up. Why haven't we done this earlier? So that was very reassuring. And we've continued to have that. They've sent the emails in. They've made phone calls. And they're still making phone calls because they're asking, well, how does this work? Oh, well, that's going to be great. And so Dustin's been answering some of those calls. I have. We know that we're not naive in thinking that everyone's going to agree on it, because we know we don't. It's evident that everyone won't, and there's going to be some pieces. But I think from the overall positive response that we've had, our community is ready. They're ready for a change, and they're ready to focus on our why, that target of choice, and looking at that social emotional health of a child. So that's all I have for discussion today.
Thank you, Jennifer.
I had actually two principals that are in other districts that have children in our district, and they were like, wow, if we can get the district they're working for now to do this, you know, that would be incredible. You know, and so they're really talking it even to their own districts, you know, and saying, hey, look, this is what Keller's doing, and this is the way we need to start moving. And so, yeah, I think it's the way we need to go. Thank you for all your work.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say is thank you. Tremendous amount of work. So much communication and collaboration with the community and coming up with this, and thank you.
I just have a question. Have you looked at what it will do to our KCAL enrollment?
See an increase in KCAL courses.
I'm thinking we will see a significant increase, because then kids feel like they have the mm-hmm. ability to do it and kind of follow their pathway to see if that's really what they want to do. Which, as a parent, when my kid goes to college, I'll be very happy. Uh-huh. If she decides, yes, she wants to be a vet tech, or no, she doesn't want to be a vet yeah. tech, based on taking classes over there.
And those classes take up two or three spots
right.
on their schedule. And so that's two or three credits. It's not going to count against them, but they just get to do something that they enjoy.
Great. Thank you, Jennifer.
Guys.
Oh, I'd like to make a comment before we're done. I didn't know we were going down the line here. Everything we do in life has a cause and effect. We don't live in a vacuum where you push on a scale on one end and nothing happens on the other. You throw a rock in a pond, no ripple, no nothing. Everything is cause and effect. And when we're talking about this up here, I hear us saying, well, we think this will happen. We think the students will do this. It sounds like more of a social experiment, and we're thinking one thing's going to happen. I mean, if it doesn't, well, I guess we'll try to fix it later down the road, which we'll probably end up doing. But the thing about it is, the biggest problem we're creating with this, we're trying to eliminate, and I'm referring really to the telling of the rankings, mm-hmm. and we do need to adjust this, we do need to fix this, but I don't think we're going in the right direction. I just want to go on the record to say, I don't think we're going in the right direction. I do believe this needs to be fixed, but I think we need to tweak what we're doing. I don't think we've hit the promised land with this, and I think everybody up here thinks we've hit the promised land, we've got a perfect deal, but we don't. And here's where the flaws are, and I like to point a few of these out. When we're looking at the GPA, we're talking about the 10%, mm-hmm. we're going to tell the kids they're in the top 10, and I'm assuming you're going to tell them 9%, 8%, or whatever they're at. And if somebody's at 10.001, they don't know. That's what I gather from the presentation. You know, if they're 10.001, they're not going to know, because you're not going to tell them.
Yeah, they wouldn't fall within, because they would know their GPA. That's correct. They wouldn't. Or 11%. They would know how close they are.
We'll say 11%. Okay. So 11%, they're not going to know if they're 11% or 99%, or they won't know, unless they maybe specifically ask, but we didn't talk about that mm-hmm. in this presentation, so I'm assuming kids don't get to find out even if they ask or want to know.
We are setting it up for the parents to be aware of where their student is. They would be able to see it, but it's not something that we would put on the transcript. So we're not sending out on the transcript every time that a kid is a 50th percentile or wherever they're ranked past that 10%, because it could be detrimental to injury.
Yeah.
GPA is always on there, though.
Just to be honest, we can kind of peel back the onion a little bit, and we can kind of say 2/3 of the kids in this district really don't care what rank they are anyway. If you're number 300 of 600, does it really matter? I mean, they're not going to sit there and say, ooh, I better work really hard. I'm in 11th grade. I need to get in that top 10%. It's not really going to, I had four kids graduate high school, and I got one in there now, so I've experienced kids all over the place in this ranking thing. And I've gone through this four times. So I can tell you that a kid is at 300 out of 600, we probably don't need to tell them that, and that's one of your things in here that we don't really list it. And that's probably good, because I've experienced the kids seeing that, and it brings them down. They get depressed, because there's really, at that time of the game, 11th grade, there's nothing you're going to do about it. There's nothing they can do about it. And so they're kind of stuck, and they see that on their transcript, and they kind of, or their report card, and they kind of get down, because they know they can't do anything. So I can see not telling a range of kids what that is, because it's not going to be helpful to them, and it just makes them sad. But there's a range of kids, probably the upper third, that probably need to know what that is, the 11%er. One of the fatal things that we're not recognizing is the greatest fear of mankind, and that's fear of the unknown. How many times have we feared something going into some situation, and when the situation's over with, we say, that wasn't near as bad as I thought it was. That's what happens to the 11% kid. He's thinking, oh my gosh, the world's gonna fall. And he doesn't know he's at 11%. I mean, he's so close. All he has to do is tweak a few things, he's probably there. But he doesn't know that. And so his world is gonna crash down until somebody says, you're 11%. And he's gonna go, ooh, man, okay, I thought I was really not doing too good. And I hope we're telling the kid that's 9% that he's at 9%, because they're gonna be freaking out if they don't know, because they don't know if they're at 9 or fixing to fall off the cliff, or if they're at 1, they don't know. So this fear of the unknown is what's gonna grip the kids, and that's what we're not thinking about. If you're not telling them anything, they're gonna assume the worst case scenario. And this all doesn't affect, but just, you know, really the top third, top 20%, whatever percent you wanna pick, more than the top 10. That's what I wanna say. And you've got to tell these kids that are at 11 and 12 and 13 where they're at, especially when they have time to do something about it, and they can make modifications to their schedule. If they're gonna focus on some of these classes that we picked, they might wanna rearrange their schedule so they can focus and get their GPA up on these select classes. If they don't know, they're not gonna know to focus on these, you know, classes more than they already are. And the thing is, if a kid knows that he's not doing very good, he's gonna put more effort into it. So if he knows he's at 12 and he just needs to get off the game a little bit, you know, video game, he may do that and bump it up. But if he thinks he's at 25, he's gonna be on that video game. He may not care. So that's why I say you can't keep kids in the dark. You're gonna have people stressing out, the kids, or you're gonna have kids not caring when maybe they should care. And so anyway, that's my take.
So Brad, if you don't mind, when you're talking about the 10% or the 11% that you were discussing, the parents are gonna have access to the child's GPA. So what I guess what I wanna make sure I'm fully understanding is when we go back and start looking at this a little bit more before we bring policy forward in the next month or two for the board. Is it that if it sits at 11, if I tell you you're at 11%, you might not have any idea what is involved to get from 11% to 10%. But if you know your GPA, if you know you're off by 0.3 of a point, let's say, I don't even know what that cut would be. But if you're off by 0.3 of a point, you can actually start figuring out, well, what grades do I need to get to close that 0.3 of a point gap? So regardless of whether or not that's 11% or 10.5 or 13% in terms of ranking, if I know my GPA and I know where the 10% cut is, so if I'm 0.3 away, then I know how to strategize my, whether it's grades that I need to earn or classes I need to take, because I know I've got to close that 0.3 of a percent or 0.3 gap. I'm not even talking class rank anymore. So I think what you're saying is what the system that we're trying to put in place is just we're doing it differently because we're focusing it more on GPA instead of the actual percentage, because a percentage, saying I'm at 11%, doesn't necessarily message to me as a student or a parent, well, I don't even know how much ground I have to cover to get to that 10%, but if I know my exact GPA and I know how far that is away from 10%, from the top 10, now I know exactly how to calculate that. So it really doesn't make any difference what percentage I am at that point, because I know exactly where my GPA is. If that were open, is that what you're trying?
I think we're saying the unknown same piece. Thing I'm saying.
And yeah. They're going to have the cutoff.
I think it's semantics at this point, and we're just trying to get the right
system.
They're
going to know what the cutoff is. So they're going to know what they have to get to.
We'll make sure we publish cutoff.
They know what the 10%
yes.
is.
We will make sure we publish. Yes, sir.
No. Everybody's going to know the cutoff.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Not just a 10, but I would go, you know, 15, 20.
But we 20. And we've talked about quartiles before.
You can do that.
You know, in terms of.
I had a kid trying to get the 20, you know.
Right. Right. Now, I understand the unknown piece. I think what the system that they're working on, which is a little bit more extra effort because they're actually working on some behind the scenes piece on the computer coding side, is so that parents can see what those GPAs are so that they really truly will know and take away some of that unknown that this process might unintentionally create.
Well, and the student can always go to their counselor and receive that information as well, right? Did you hear that, Brad? I think you may have missed earlier that the student can always meet with their counselor and get that information for themselves. It doesn't have to come through the parent.
We have so that now.
You know, the focus is for them to work with that counselor because that counselor should also be helping them meet their goals and helping steer them to get where they want to be personally. So they maintain that relationship. It actually kind of enforces that relationship because that's where they need to get the data. So they get the information and help in the same place instead of just looking at a piece of paper and not knowing what to do with it.
As long as you know, like what you were saying, Rick, I mean, if you got the numbers on there to, that they need to obtain,
right,
that'll work.
Yeah,
otherwise,
yeah,
if you don't have that, though, everybody's going to talk to the counselor, and they're going to be overloaded.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. No.
Nobody wants that, trust me.
We'll figure out a way to make sure that people aren't feeling like they're guessing at something.
Oh. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Jennifer.
Thanks, Jennifer.
Great discussion. All right. Next thing on our agenda are scheduling and upcoming events.
We have a few things coming up.
Yes, you
just
do.
A few.
Yeah. So Monday is Community Ambassadors. That's going to be at the Annex. And in addition to that, we also have our third education summit that I talked about earlier, and that's going to be at Central High School from 6 to 8. And then Tuesday, we have our Vista Ridge Middle School dedication and also the education summit at Tribal Council. So we'll clone ourselves, and we'll do the very best we can do. For the sake of the trustees, so they know what I'm going to be doing on those 2 days, I'll be at the education summit on Monday the 16th, and then I will, as that, depending on how that's going, I'll try to come back over to the community ambassadors, but I will start my evening on the 17th at Vista Ridge Middle School and then join education summit when that's done. October the 21st, we have our bullying prevention summit at KCAL. That's an all-day event. The 26th is our next brown bag at Chisholm Trail Intermediate. And then obviously we're back in here on November the 9th with the next community ambassadors on the November 13th date.
Okay. Sounds like a great
week.
Great month. Anything else? We do not have to have a second executive session, so do I have a motion for adjournment?
Summit.
Karina, do I have a second?
Second.
Second, Chris. Thank you. All those in favor. Thank you very much.
No, I want to stay.